And welcome to CMRS first seminar of the spring semester of 2016. Today we have Dr. Alexandra Proust, who is going to talk about the founding of a coming book she is publishing on a very interesting and understudied population, which is the population of the Gypsies in Egypt. She will focus, I think, on the identity formation of the Gypsies in Egypt. She will talk for like 30 minutes or 45 minutes. And then we will have some time for discussions and questions. Let me just first introduce her, and then we'll give the floor to her. So Dr. Alexandra Proust is an associate professor of sociology in the sociology department of AUC and the Center for Migration and Refugee Studies at AUC. She earned her PhD from Paris University. Her dissertation focused on the construction of an Arab American community. Her current research focuses on the Dome communities or the Gypsy communities in Egypt and the Middle East. She is also interested in museums and national identity and ethnic minorities in general. She has taught and researched in the United States, Sultanate of Oman, and Burma before coming to Egypt. So, thank you, Dr. Price, for coming today and talking to CMRS Seminar Series, and the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much, Maïssa. So, let's see, I think the volume is okay, yeah? Well, first of all, thank you so much for showing interest in the Gypsy communities of Egypt. I have conducted research on this population for the past 2 years, and I think I got really interested in Gypsies, and then I will explain why I use the term Gypsies, because I am European, so the Roma population is very important in Europe, very discriminated against, and very talked about. And then I came to Egypt, and I realized that there was indeed a group of Gypsy. There might be up to about 1 million Gypsy in Egypt, and there's also a Gypsy population throughout the Middle East. I also found out that they were, as Melissa said, very under-researched, and one of the main publications about the Dom or the Gypsy is by Nabil Sopihana, and it was published in 1982. So there's been like sporadic publications since then, but very little. So I thought it would be a very interesting topic to look at, but of course it's also very dangerous. Because when you start to examine a population that has been so understudied, you run a lot of risks. You might essentialize them. You might just like display them as some exotic population that is so fascinating and sort of talk about the different traditions and so forth, which is absolutely not what I wanted to do. So that's why I decided to approach my topic from different angles. Before I talk about the angles, I want to talk briefly about this picture and the term Gypsy. So this picture was designed for one of the articles that I wrote for the International Sociology Association. And when I wrote the article, they asked me for a picture, and I didn't have a picture. So they said, okay, we'll make one for you. And this is what they made. I find it very interesting. Of course, it's a little orientalist, right? So you've got Gypsies in Egypt, and you've got pyramids, and you've got female Gypsy dancing, beautiful, sensual, and then you've got the Gypsy wheel on top instead of the sun, which is the symbol of the Gypsy. So this is actually quite an interesting picture because it also embodies a lot of the representations that people have of Gypsies, like sensual, beautiful dancers, khawazi, and sort of like exotic creatures. You know, in the desert and moving. So that's something that I will be talking about now. Another thing is the term Gypsy. So if you're familiar with Romani studies, you might know that it's a very controversial term. And in Europe, typically people would talk about Roma and not really Gypsy. Gypsy is often seen as a little bit negative. I'm using it, however, for a variety of reasons. First of all, I don't know if you know the origin of the term Gypsy. It's Egyptian. Because when the Gypsies came to Europe, Supposedly from India, actually, as we will see, people didn't know where they were coming from, and so they saw these individuals that looked different, and they assumed they were Egyptians. So the term Egyptians was changed into Gypsy, and for a long time Europeans believed that Gypsies were actually Egyptian. So that's one thing. Second is, if we talk about the population here in Egypt, they are called the Dom, and which is a sort of a parallel term to the Roma. You've got the Roma, you've got the Dom, and you've got the Lom. But no one knows that term. So that's the scientific term, but it's only used by researchers, the few researchers who study the Dom of the Middle East. And if you talk to people who are themselves Gypsy, they wouldn't really know what you're talking about. And I believe that you should call people what they call themselves. So there is another word, I think, that is used a lot, and it's Hagar, which would be the equivalent of Gypsy in Arabic. And then you've got other names. So I will be, throughout this presentation, going mostly from Gypsy to Hagar. I won't use the term Dom too often, it might slip sometimes, but I just wanted to clarify why I was using Gypsy in the title of my presentation. Okay, now, so the outline of what I will be talking about is the first, I call it roots and routes, and just to give you a little bit of background about where Egyptian Gypsies, the Doms, are from. And I will show you that there's a variety of, so Gypsy, Orientalized Gypsies in the Orient, in one way or another, because that's really the narrative that was developed in the 19th century by the scholars. okay? Now, again, I will go a little bit faster. What is very interesting is that sort of like scientific narrative. And again, it's very contested. Even now in Europe, people don't want to link necessarily Romas to India because that's very racializing them. So it's also very dangerous. But what happened in Egypt is that there was this movement of creating a similarity between, obviously, the Romas and the Doms. What I found more interesting almost is the explanations, the alternative explanation that you can find in Egypt about the origins of the Doms. And so many people I've spoken with, some articles I've read, you know, just like vastly different opinions. For some, they are just another tribe. They have these sort of like tribal features with specific occupations, which is peddling or folk medicine or entertainment and so forth. And specific tribes, I think you've seen the names, have also different names. The Halabi, which may be coming from Aleppo, so from Syria. Right? The Nawar, the Hagar, the Khawazi. The Khawazi, I was talking about with Meisa, which may be a tribe of dancers, entertainers, baby dancers. So you've got all of them. That's the first sort of like representation. Of course, it's what is very important is that in all the representation, you see that they are anchored in a sense of difference. The groups are different. They are other. They are not like us. Why? Because they are a different tribe. Why? Because they come from India. Why? Because geographically they come from somewhere else. So if you're in Cairo, you hear people say, well, they come from the desert. They come from Upper Egypt. They come from Arabia. They come from Spain. They come from Hungary. So they always come from somewhere else. Historically, I've read explanation saying that there may have been lost Jewish tribes. They were Pharaonic soldiers. They were Romans. They were Copt. So there is a list of different theories that people use, but they're always othering and creating a sense of difference. There's also the sort of like more religious, maybe more moral description that assume that the Gypsies are the sons of Cain, and because they are sons of traders, their whole life has to be spent sort of like wandering for the world. Another one is that there may have been thieves that stole nails that were to be used for crucifixion of Jesus Christ. And in some cases, the punishment for being thief is that they had to wander throughout the world, and other, you know, narratives look at the fact that they alleviated the pain of Jesus Christ, so therefore they are blessed, and they've got this negative prestige. So clearly, we have a lot of very different explanation. And why is that? It's because we have a lot of space. We have a lot of free space. So it's a bit of a free-for-all, and anyone can create or project in the Gypsies their own preoccupation, their own fears, their own desires. And they play this role of like the social buffer. Another reason why they are not so widely studied as they have been in Europe is because I think one thing, in Europe they represented a threat to national identity, national security, because they were nomads. Of course, not all Gypsies are nomads, that's clear. And there too, there is a lot of literature pointing at that. But the perception was they were nomads. So in an area of the world where the nation state fixed borders, allegiance to only one state is so important. If you're crossing borders, you're a threat to national identity. You're a threat to, you know, national unity. So that's really bad. Second, there was a linguistic difference. And the Romans were really identified as speaking Romani, which was not the case with Dom. Now, the Dom and Domari, maybe you know something better than I do, but I haven't found a single study of the linguistic analysis of Domari. There is an analysis by Yadin Matras in Israel, done on the Doms of Jerusalem, and then our orientalist, Van Kramer, I collected a list of vocabulary, but it's not enough words to actually really engage in anything. So no one really constructed the difference on language. And the last one, very prosaically, is there was a definite lack of interest. Perhaps because they were not such a threat, perhaps because they were not so disturbing, perhaps because they were so invisible. There was such a lack of interest that the sort of like construction, the boundaries, the explanations around who the gypsies are were never clear. So let me go to my second part, which is that, I forgot the most important part. What are the Dom thinking about where they're coming from? So I've asked some Haga I've been talking with, sort of, tell me, who are you? Where are you coming from? Which is always a very delicate question, but I had always a very good translator with me. And so what I've noticed is, on one hand, there is this sort of internalization of difference. So the sense that they are different. And they say, we are different because we come from another era. We come from Upper Egypt. We come from the desert. Our families are from elsewhere. So sort of the same thing. Some of them have been drawing a link with what they call the European Haga. And I remember I was talking with a family, and they said, yeah, European Haga, we know about them. And one daughter said, oh, yes, I've seen the Hunchback of Notre Dame on TV. And so she is dying. And so you see some description. They have mean eyes, or they have central bodies, or so on and so forth. And this idea of linking gypsies to animal features was already highlighted in the work of Judith Ockley, who is a Romani scholar of high importance, and she worked very much with gypsies and travelers as well in the UK, and she would know that people would create some, you know, racial difference, just like imagine that those differences are actually perceptible in the physical appearance. If we continue, we also have the linguistic differences. So they don't really, I haven't really found a language with a very strong structure, but Gypsies or Dom or Hagar are, from what I've heard, speaking certain words of a code. It's called the Sin, it's called in Arabic. And so there is, based on the interview I conducted, there is not really a language, but it's just certain terms and certain words that they are using. Okay, so there is this aspect that what they are saying, now on the outside of the boundary, people who are non-Gypsy would say they speak a different language. The language is incomprehensible. The language is untranslatable. And again, the idea would be that if the language is untranslatable, they are culturally untranslatable. So symbolically, they are so alien and so different. So we can continue like that. Spatial marginalization, of course, they are very often situated in very marginal space. And the last one is the occupational marginalization, which means that it's very hard to create this group as a racial or ethnic group because it's such a fragmented representation. Now, what happens, and it's something that happens in Europe as well, is is very often robbers, are the difference in who they are is based on their occupation and the role they fulfill in society. Okay, and so a lot of researchers like David Mayall, who is a Romani scholar, is always asking this question: when we talk about Roma, are we talking about an ethnic group? Or are we talking about a marginalized group, which marginalization is based on their social situation and their occupation? So it's always sort of like going from one to the other. And here as well, what I found was that their occupation, what they were doing, and the interactions through those occupations that they had with the non-Hagar was really what was defining them. So, let's continue. If you have any questions, no? Yes. Yes, okay, sure.
They have their own code within Arabic?
Yes. So they have their own code. And again, if you refer to you know, the sort of like 19th century writing, that would be they had glossaries of Domari, what they call Domari language, which is their sort of like sister language to Romani. And but they had just like very tiny glossaries. Now, Domari has been studied by Yaron Matras, and he saw himself within Domari import from Sanskrit as well as large import from Arabic, but he was able to come up with, you know, grammatical structures. Here, it has not been done. So all we have is this glossary. So what interested me was, again, I'm not a linguist, but was the representation. So from the outside, many non-Hagar I talk with would say, well, the Hagar have this language called Sin, which means the code. No one ever talked about the Mary. And they have this language, and it's not comprehensible. Sopihana also talked about that. And presented it as a way to exclude. So they would speak Sim so no one would understand them. Talking to Hagar, I asked them, do you know of this language? And most of the time the answer was, it's a dead language, we do not use it anymore. We only use certain words in certain context. Yes, when we don't want to be heard. Might be police officer, might be nice necklace. It might be in very specific context, but they all specifically said it was only some words that were left. Okay?
Question. The Roma in Europe adopt Christianity, so every is sort of local, because you said they pretend to be Muslim or are Muslims, and they also discriminated against them, sometimes, you know, put into, you know, into their own places and destroy their camps, etc. So I'm just saying, so they adopt a local language to be more acceptable.
Yes, absolutely. So they typically, all Gypsies in the Arab world are Muslim, just like the Roma in Europe are Christian. So they do adopt the religion. But what I found interesting is, although they adopt the religion, you would think that it creates some kind of proximity, but it doesn't. And people still continue to say, okay, they are Muslim, but they're not good Muslim. So even though there is this religious proximity, the boundaries, the fragment of boundaries are still created, and I think it's exactly the same in Europe, where while the Romans are indeed Christians, they might not be the right Christians, or they might not act, they don't want to integrate, they don't want to be like us, they want to be different, although they are integrating a lot of local practices.
Sim
is the language, so that was the question that... it means Sim. Which means code in Arabic, right? Yeah, so it's code.
Code?
Yeah. Yeah. So already very cryptic and mysterious. Okay, how am I doing on time?
We're enjoying so far.
Sexual, exotic, marriageable, to blah, blah, blah. And the last one is criminal and matriarchal structures. And I think this is very interesting for one reason, is that being criminal and being, you know, having matriarchal structures are both not very Egyptian. And they are sort of like constructing the Gypsies in an opposition to a national identity. They are morally, you know, attacking what it means to be Egyptian. You shouldn't be a criminal, and you shouldn't let your wife decide on everything. It's still very much a patriarchal society. So these are absolute opposite of what Egyptian society is, and that's how it has been created. So there's been this creation, and again, I explain this sort of impossible union. What is often said about the Gypsies is that it embodies society's torments. And you see that in Europe and you see that in Egypt. They are this sort of like buffer. And whenever the sort of, what is our identity, you need to have this other to see what you're not, because that other represents the torment. So for the Khalazi, when it was time of modernization, any sort of like promiscuous, archaic female had to be exiled in Upper Egypt, which happened with them. When we talk about the Gypsies, the exotic tradition, at one point, you know, on the road to modernity, you can still marry tradition, but slowly you can't anymore. And the new torment of society might not necessarily be the relationship to tradition, but relationship to underclasses and to marginalized group. And again, that's what the Gypsies are representing. The sort of like impossible union of tradition and the difficult relationship with underclass, marginalized, morally unacceptable group. Gypsies, and that's how you can see that sort of clearly in cinematographic representation. Okay, I'm going super fast. In the 5 minutes, okay, media discourse, same thing. So particularly after Prison of Women, the group is really represented. If you haven't done so, and if you're interested, Google Prison of Women and see what is being said about that. And it's again, this exotic weird group. All women are criminal, and sure, potentially Gypsies were criminal, but not all of them. And so they are defined. No one knows where they're coming from. And that's in many of these articles, that's when they use, you know, the sons of Cain, and they're stolen, you know, from the Christ, but they are criminal. So who they are really is embodied in their criminality and in what is perceived as their matriarchal structures. There's also very often the sort of blaming the victim. They're not criminal because they are poor, because all of them are rich. Because they've been feeding so much that they are rich, so they're criminal because they've got that in the blood. That's the sort of discourse that continues to go on. Now, last part, and potentially, hopefully, the most interesting. So I'm sorry, it's been a long sort of... I wanted to really show you how this identity is being constructed by fragments in discourses and boundaries, and there's still a lot of space. But there's space, but at the same time there's limited space. So how do the Gypsies, how do the Hagar negotiate that space? What I found is, on one hand, there is a strong rejection of identity, which is something that is very common as well in Europe, where you know, members of the groups, we're not Roma, we're not Hagar, we're not Gypsy. And so what do you do? Okay, again, Judy Oakley would say that the only Gypsy is the person who defines themselves as a Gypsy. So you can't tell them you're a Gypsy. If they say you're not a Gypsy, they're not a Gypsy. You can believe because of what they need, because of what the neighbors say, but if there is this rejection, and this rejection happens a lot, on one hand. What I've noticed, and I call that, you know, Goffmanian sort of like impression management, is that there is sometimes, you know, denial of identity, and sometimes they overemphasize their identity. And the decision of what to do with your identity is very often based on who you are interacting with. Okay, that's the basic of impression management. So if you want to be a fortune teller, you need to be a Gypsy, because Gypsies are supposed to have the gift. So I have met fortune tellers, and they would say, first, no, we're not Gypsy. And I said, well, I just want to have my fortune told by a Gypsy. So, okay, we are Gypsy. We're not just Hagar, we're Halebi. And apparently the Halebi are the best fortune tellers. So, you know, there's a denial of identity to acceptation to actually specifically wear Halebi. And so you see these sort of interactions. And the relationship is always very temporary with the non-Hagar, which I found very interesting. So again, with the fortune tellers, they would read your fortune, and there's a very sort of like systematic way of doing it. They would like use shell necklace. They would of course invoke the evil eye, because
Everybody in Egypt is scared of the evil eye, or someone is jealous of you. And so immediately, like, oh my God, protect me, because you're a little bit scared. And they would go on, and you pay, and then they get rid of the evil eye, and then you disappear. And so that's how it sort of like come, leave, and that is this sort of very temporary planned encounters that both sides are comfortable with. The service provider. What was very interesting, for instance, in terms of like the relationship that I created with others, I spoke with individual who were working with organization who give loans to Gypsy and give them money and then receive the money. What you see. So there's this negotiation in a very tight space for them. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alex.
And now, very, very interesting. And I guess we have many questions. We will start by taking three questions at a time, and then Alex will answer, and then we'll take other three questions. However, I would like to I have some questions. I have many questions, but one of the questions that comes, I need some time to think about more questions, but something that comes to my mind is, now, Gypsies, we're talking about a population, but why it's always the focus on women?
Yeah.
Why? What do you know about men? Why men from this population are never portrayed in the media or in the movies or so on? That's one thing. The other thing is that I felt from your presentation that the reason why they have struggle with their identity and they play with it, it's because they are not seen as Egyptian by the people. The people kind of, the Egyptian population kind of, or any population in Europe also, they marginalize them, right? But how do they feel about it? Do they don't feel at all that they are Egyptian? Because I guess they are third and fourth generation, and how are they?
20th generation. Yeah.
And how do they live? Do they live in communities, mingle with other people, or they are segregated even in their communities? And then politically, do they have the Egyptian citizenship? Do they have IDs? Okay, so I'm not going to go further because we need to give the microphone, so we need three questions.
It's not questions, just a comment. First of all, I would like to thank you very much for this interesting presentation. And the second slide attracted me very much because the second one, which is with the map, yes. Because here it appears that Gypsy is initiated from India and they moved in three streams, one to Rome and the other to Turkish and Syria in Halabi, and the third one go to Egypt. And this attracted me to review all the history I studied before, and I have another explanation to the Gypsy of Egypt, because I think they are initiated from Egypt, from those who dance in the pharaonic era in the temple for the religious celebration, and after that they still move from religious activity to be entertainment activity. And in the era of Cleopatra and great Alexander, maybe some group of this person moved to Rome and some other moved to Halab in Syria with the army movement of Ptolemaeus, and great Alexander maybe moved to the Halab. And the third direction, which is not mentioned here, maybe with the extent of Islamic movement from Egypt to all the North Africa, because I found in Morocco, in Marrakesh exactly, some group of Gypsy also, and they have the same occupation of entertainment and criminal in Sahat al-Fala exactly. So I think this part from Morocco also moved in the era of Tariq Mizyat to Spain, maybe. So I think you can adjust this map to be two initial group of Gypsy, one from India and the other from Egypt.
Yes.
And thank you.
Just to answer your question, I think it's interesting. What I wanted to show is this is sort of the
European-based perception, okay? They are coming from India and based on linguistic explanation. And this was brought in by the Orientalists, you know, this like mimicry, and they're like, okay, we have Romas, and here we have Gypsies. The Romas came from India, the Gypsies here, the Doms do. So that is one narrative. Now, I contrasted it with other narratives, and I didn't talk about, the Fernic one, I've got the soldiers, so some from Fernic, Romans, Copts, maybe I will add this one, which is people have said that the Hewazi were similar to dancers found in the tombs, ancient tombs. So there is a very, there's a variety of narratives, which I think is very interesting, because it's not just a sort of like route that is very clearly accepted, but here there are different ones. Yes.
Thanks so much for your talk. I wondered if you could tell us a little bit about your research process, how you went about identifying Gypsies.
Yes.
Yes, thanks.
Okay.
Thank you for a very, very interesting lecture, and you picked a subject that hasn't been studied, so you'll be a pioneer. I want to play the devil's advocate here. Number one, thieves of meals, and you alluded to it, that means they are the good guys. Of course, there's enough meals to go around to crucify Christ, but taking the meals is a good deed. A second thing, emasculating the men by the woman, sort of like I said, the guy lighting the cigarette, that is gender equality. So that's again, you know, something very good. And nowadays in the Western world, we offer men to stay home with the kids. So.
But it's a group that navigates really fast and is not necessarily identified. So I think they are, in a way, moving very fast and not, you know, looking promiscuous anymore. But I'm just, it's an assumption. I haven't, you know, dug into that, so something else to do.
How far back can you trace the history of Gypsies in Egypt? What are the earliest firm references to them in the literature?
Okay, that's a very hard question because, again, my answer will be, I don't know. There is so much uncertainty around them. And the first real descriptions were 18th, 19th century Europeans who took an interest in them. So I think one of the narratives would be that they came, you know, if you follow the Roma, Lom, Dom, they would have come to Egypt between the 7th and the 12th century. But there is very little literature on them. So the Hawazi, you know, you could have some. So you've got fragments in the past. There might be some allusions from Europeans maybe in the 16th, 17th century. But again, there is nothing fixed. And it's based on the assumption. So if you believe that they have followed the Lom, Dom, Rom, they would arrive 6th to 7th, 12th century. If you believe they were, you know, soldiers or Jewish tribe, they would have been there much longer. If you think that they were actual dancers in the pyramids, they would have been there much longer. So this is the sort of like impossibility without fixing anything that is both fascinating, and I, doing this research very often I felt like I was just like assuming things and I was just like exploring things, but I also didn't want to be fixed because I didn't want to close any doors, and I don't want to essentialize or genify anything. So that was my not very direct answer, but
I have a comment. I just want to just comment that for me, and I am, and it's not based on any on research or reading or anything on the topic, but rather from watching Egyptian movies. My understanding was that there are two different categories, the Ghawazi and the Ghabar. The Ghawazi, for me, it meant a belly dancer. It didn't mean anyone who is not Egyptian. It's an Egyptian belly dancer, but more in Upper Egypt. And even the movies that you were talking about, when the person was not accepted by the family to marry, it's not because she's not Egyptian, it's because she's a belly dancer. While the Ghabar, in my understanding, is a different community or a different. So I just wanted to comment.
Yeah, and again, it's still a debate. So Burton and von Kramer and Newbold were, and Edward Lane, you know Edward Lane, the manners of modern Egyptians, he loved talking about the Hawazi because they were so beautiful. And he said, well, he didn't think they were gypsies because they were too beautiful to be gypsies. And so Newbold, you know, when you're the gypsies, they are kind of like dishonest, so they are gypsies. So, you know, there's been always this discussion. What are the perceptions? Nowadays, people who write about Hawazi, and that's why I put that slide, are the expert in belly dancing. And there's a crowd of people who love belly dancing just because it's good for fitness, I think. And so there's famous belly dancers and teachers. And they also talk about that. They're like, Hawazi Egyptians, are they gypsies or not? Oh, yes, they're gypsies because they have, you know, this beautiful black hair. Oh, no, because actually their skin is pale. So it's very racialist and racist, of course. But there is still all these discussions. Now, to answer your earlier question, Mesa, about being foreigners, it is also, is it, and my question, is it always this European imposition of gypsies come from India, and we identified gypsies here, so they must come from India. And a lot of people say, no, they come from here, they are Egyptian. They come from the Delta, they come from the desert, they come from... So this sort of like the foreignness is not so anchored in foreign nation states. It might be anchored in difference in occupation, in difference in morals, in being tribal, in coming from this place, that place, in having been cropped, in having been followers. So there is all these, you know, difference of anchors for creating different foreignness, which is not nation state based, which is the case in Europe. So I think there's like a different, and still now, I mean, people would say, yes, they come from Upper Egypt. It's something because, you know, they were at weddings, they were family figures in the country of Upper Egypt. So, again, it's what is fixed is that they are different from other. What creates the otherness is, yes, you know, it's very, and since there is very little research, it's a lot of like, trying to figure things out, but yeah.
And geographically, where they're located,
oh, yes,
is primarily in the north, south?
So initially, they were a very rural population, so the Delta and Upper Egypt. And then, you know, a lot of them, I guess, in the 60s, 70s, moved to Cairo. So they became urban, so they are now in Cairo and Alexandria. And I think it's also when I talked about this sort of like change in identity from the rural exotic to the urban criminal, that's also what happened. So in a sort of like rural environment, they were the entertainer, tribal, you know, reading the future, they were specializing in like animal, veterinary science, and they were more integrated as sort of like, yeah, exotic. They were not such a threat as they might seem now when they are, you know, an underclass teen criminal in urban centers.
Collectively speaking, where do you think the gypsies want to be 50 years from now?
Where do they want to be 50 years from now? I don't know. And that's a very good question, which I mean, I always ask myself this question. Is it better to be invisible and write less, or visible and have some right potentially, they are very invisible. Every time I ask them, would you like to be more united, you know, because like the in Europe, the Romas have created these Romanis organizations. So in one hand, it's good. They can be politicized, they can fight for their rights, they can say this is who we are. But at the same time, it's also crystallizing. They lose a little bit of their freedom because now they are clearly a Gypsy or a Dom or a Romani. They cannot just like decide what they want. So I don't really, you know, with the future of the Gypsies, I don't know, but I'm not sure they will get organized. Will they dissolve and disappear as a group? I don't think so either, because they've been around for a long time and still there is all these boundaries. Perhaps, unfortunately,